Hello everyone, welcome back to lesson 2 of Elements of Mechanical Engineering, module 1, where we'll be discussing about the sources of energy and its conversion, as well as the concepts of thermodynamics and the steam and its formation. So in the lesson 1, we did discuss about the definition of energy, the sources from where we can derive energy, as well as the classification. So under classification, we did discuss renewable and non-renewable. So under non-renewable energy sources, we did discuss the formation of fossil fuels, namely coal, petroleum and natural gas. So how this energy from these fossil fuels can be converted into mechanical engineering, mechanical energy, in turn into electrical energy. So moving ahead further, so now we'll discuss one more energy conversion process, which we call it as hydropower or idle power. As you know that water also possesses energy in the form of potential energy as well as in the kinetic energy. So when do water possess potential energy? The stored water normally possesses potential energy. Potential energy is nothing but the water will be having an high pressure when it is being stored. So that is what we call it as potential energy. When the water is made to flow, so then it obviously it gains kinetic energy. So that is nothing but the kinetic energy possessed by the water. So water possesses both potential energy as well as kinetic energy. So why don't we make use of the energy possessed by this water and convert that into other forms? So that can be done by the use of hydropower plant. So when can we extract the potential energy and the kinetic energy of the water? So that can be extracted if the water is being stored at an higher height, and that is what we call it as head of water. And at the same time, we should have a huge quantity or an volume of water that flows towards the water turbine. So then only we'll be able to extract the energy possessed by the water and convert that into mechanical energy and in turn into electrical energy. Now let's see how this hydropower plant works. So this is the schematic diagram of an hydropower plant. So what you can see here is the reservoir. How do we create a reservoir? So it is nothing but an artificially we can create a reservoir by constructing a dam across a downstream. So whenever there is a rain or whenever there is a flow of water naturally, obviously the water flows the downstream. So if you can create an artificial dam across the downstream, you can create a reservoir to store the flowing water. And away from this dam, around 1 to 2 kilometers from the dam, we can construct this powerhouse. So powerhouse is the one where actually we will be running the turbine. Running the turbine means where we will be utilizing the energy possessed by the water and convert that into mechanical energy, in turn into electrical energy. So when the powerhouse is situated 1 to 2 kilometers away from it, so what we normally do is we have to carry the water from the reservoir to the powerhouse. So how do we carry it? So we can carry it by means of a penstock. So what is a penstock? So penstocks are nothing but water pipes. So it is nothing but a large diameter pipes which carries huge quantity of water from the reservoir to the powerhouse. So when in the event of this, when the water is being carried from the reservoir to the powerhouse, so automatically when the water is stored in the reservoir, it possesses potential energy. When it is made to flow down around 1 to 2 kilometers from the reservoir, by the time it reaches the powerhouse, so all this potential energy gets converted into kinetic energy. There is nothing but the velocity energy. If the water gains velocity, then only it can move from one point to another point. So in the event of making the water to move from the reservoir towards the powerhouse, so all the potential energy slowly gets converted into kinetic energy and thereby pushing the water from the reservoir towards the powerhouse. So at the powerhouse, what we do is, so at the end of the penstocks, normally we will be having a nozzle. So what is a nozzle? Nozzle is an expansion device, so which convert pressure energy into kinetic energy. So even though during its flow pressure energy are being converted into kinetic energy, which makes the water to flow further, so all the pressure will not be converted into kinetic energy. So by the use of nozzle, we will be able to convert the pressure energy processed by the water into kinetic energy. So using this nozzle, it is nothing but an divergent and convergent and divergent device, so which can convert pressure energy into kinetic energy. As it converts pressure energy into kinetic energy, so water coming out of the nozzle will be having an high kinetic energy. That means to say, water will be oozing out of the nozzle as a jet of water, which is very high in kinetic energy. So this jet of water is made to hit the turbine blade. So here you can see these are the turbine. So this turbine will be having an blades. So high kinetic energy possessed by the water in the form of a stream of water is made to hit the turbine blades. So obviously the turbine blades, which are fixed over a shaft, so this blade starts rotating, in turn the shaft starts rotating. That means to say, the kinetic energy possessed by the water is now being absorbed, which makes the turbine blades to rotate. That means to say, we have converted the kinetic energy possessed by the water into mechanical energy. What is mechanical energy? Rotation of the shaft. So once you can convert kinetic energy of possessed by the water into mechanical energy, obviously mechanical energy in turn can be converted into electrical energy by coupling that turbine with a generator. So thereby the mechanical energy in turn is converted into electrical energy, and through the transmission line the electrical energy is taken out for our usage. So this is how an hydropower plant works. We are basically trying to extract the energy possessed by the water. So potential energy and the kinetic energy possessed by the water are converted into mechanical energy. Mechanical energy in turn is converted into electrical energy. So this is how we trap. So once it gives out all the energy here, so obviously what happens? It loses. Water loses the kinetic energy, because that kinetic energy is being absorbed by the turbine blades. So once it loses, so there will be a drop in the kinetic energy, and that water, which is low in kinetic energy and low in pressure, so pressure will be more or less, it becomes normal pressure, so it is made to flow back into the river. So this is how we will be able to extract the energy possessed by the water. So this is what we call it as hydropower plants. So now let me show you a video how this hydropower plant works. Have a look of this video.
Hydropower. Hydropower, or hydroelectricity, refers to the conversion of energy from flowing water into electricity. It is considered a renewable energy source because the water cycle is constantly renewed by the sun. One of the first uses of hydro energy was for mechanical milling, such as grinding grains. But today, modern hydro plants produce electricity using turbines and generators. The mechanical energy created by moving water spins rotors on a turbine. This turbine is connected to an electromagnetic generator, which produces electricity when the turbine spins. There are two main types of hydroelectricity production: dams and run-of-river. Hydro dams utilize the potential energy from dammed water to produce electricity. A dam is a large barrier constructed to raise the level of water and control its flow. The elevation created by the dam creates gravitational force for turning the turbine when water is released. Some dams also contain an additional reservoir at their base where water is stored to be pumped to the higher reservoir for release when electricity is in demand. This is referred to as pumped storage hydro. The second form of hydroelectricity production is run-of-river hydro. Run-of-river still uses turbines and generators, but relies on natural water flow rates of rivers, diverting just a portion of the water through turbines. Because run-of-river hydro is subject to natural water variability, it is more intermittent than dammed hydro. There are various sizes of hydro plants that produce electricity. Large hydro, greater than 30 megawatts, small hydro, 100 kilowatts to 30 megawatts, and micro hydro, less than 100 kilowatts. The Hoover Dam in the United States is a whopping 2,074 megawatts, which is enough to serve 1.3 million people. Of all renewable energy sources, hydropower holds the largest share of worldwide electricity production. Hydropower has several benefits. It is a cost-competitive form of electricity, even though the initial building cost can be high. It is quite reliable compared to other renewable options and pairs well with other sources as it can be used as baseload power. In some cases, dammed reservoirs can also help with flood control and be a reliable water supply for communities. There are also some concerns with hydropower, especially when it comes to large dams. Damming a river has a major impact on the local environment, changing wildlife habitats, blocking fish passage, and often forcing people in riverside communities to move out of their homes. In addition, dam failures can be catastrophic, claiming the lives of those living downstream. Hydro plants are also not completely free of greenhouse gas emissions. As with most forms of energy, carbon dioxide emissions happen during construction, particularly due to the large quantities of cement used. And plant matter in the flooded areas makes methane, another greenhouse gas, as it decays underwater. That's hydropower.
So that is how an hydropower plant works. So hydropower plant, we do categorize that under conventional or non-renewable, because water is naturally available in our earth, isn't it? So we do categorize this hydropower plant under conventional sources or non-renewable sources. So fossil fuels and the hydropower plants, so these are the examples which we have discussed under conventional or non-renewable sources. Now let us move on to the second category of energy sources, which we call it as renewable or non-conventional energy sources. So renewable, as we have discussed in the last class, so it is nothing but which can be renewed or which doesn't get exhausted, at least in the time frame of the human society. Under this non-conventional or the renewable energy source, the most important power source is the solar power. So what is solar power? So now let us have a look about what is solar power. See, solar as is nothing but is the sun. It is nothing but the sun, which is the source of all life on earth. So all forms of energy are derived from the sun itself, isn't it? If the water has to flow, there should be a difference in the density that is formed by sun. If the air has to flow, there should be a difference in density that has to be done by sun. So sun is the major source for all the life on earth, and all forms of energy are derived from sun itself. So what is sun? Sun is nothing but it's a sphere of intensively, it possesses hot gaseous matter which continuously emits or which continuously generates heat by thermonuclear fusion reaction. So which converts hydrogen atoms into helium atoms. So that is sun. Sun is nothing but a sphere of hot gaseous matter which continuously emits radiations in the form of heat. So thereby thermonuclear fusion, so which convert hydrogen atoms into helium atoms. So fueled by this thermonuclear fusion reaction, the radiant energy, that is nothing but what we call it as solar energy, is transmitted to earth through the space as a quantum of energy, and that quantum of energy is what we call it as photons. Got it? So fueled by thermonuclear fusion, this radiant energy or the solar energy is transmitted to earth through the space in the form of a quantum of energy, and that quantum of energy is what we call it as photons. So at any given time, a sun radiates around 4 into 10 to the power of 26 watts. So what does this photon consist of? These photons are basically nothing but electromagnetic radiation. It is nothing but solar radiation or photons, electromagnetic radiation, all mean the same. Solar radiation is nothing but a quantum of photons. Quantum of photons is nothing but electromagnetic radiation. It is nothing but electromagnetic radiation, which has got a wide range of wavelength, from the shortest wavelength of X-rays to the longest wavelength of radio waves. It has got a wide spectrum. So it has the solar radiations, it has got all the rays in it, X-rays, gamma rays, UV rays, infrared, microwaves, radio. So it has got a wide spectrum, from the shortest wavelength of X-rays to the longest wavelength of radio waves. But if you can see here, even though it has got from the shortest wavelength to longest wavelength, so majority of the radiations That is around 99% of the solar radiation is in the narrow band of the visible spectrum from ultraviolet to infrared, isn't it? So even though it has been from X-rays to radio waves, so 99% of that are concentrated towards the narrow band, which varies from ultraviolet rays to infrared rays. Okay, so normally how much radiations we do receive on Earth? It is actually less than 1/1000th of millionth of radiations is being intercepted by the Earth when the Earth and the Sun is around 145 to 153 million kilometers. The distance between the Earth and the Sun is around 145 to 153 million kilometers. We do intercept less than 1/1000th of millionth. See how much we receive, isn't it? So out of whatever the radiations the Earth receives on the outer bands, what actually is being intercepted on the Earth's surface is different. So out of the solar radiation that is intercepted by the Earth, 30% is reflected or scattered back into the space. 30% goes back. So 30% of the radiation, it goes back. So what about next? 23% is normally consumed by evaporation, precipitation of the water in the hydrological cycle. Okay, 30% is reflected back, 23% is evaporation and condensation or convection or precipitation on the hydrological cycle. So remaining 47% is the one which actually reaches the Earth surface. Among this 47%, few is being absorbed by the atmosphere, surrounding atmosphere, land surface, ocean, and which are converted into ambient temperature. That you can just observe. We will be receiving what? One less than 1/1000th of millionth. Among that, 30% is reflected back. Among that, 23% are absorbed due to evaporation, precipitation and all those things. So 47% actually reaches. Among that, majority of that will be absorbed by the ocean and few will only be available for us on the land surface. Got it? So total amount of energy captured over a year in the Earth atmosphere in the hydrological cycle is around 3.8 into 10 to the power of 24 joules. This is an approximate value. So you can just imagine what is the diluted form of solar radiation we are receiving. In spite of this diluted form, we can still feel the intensity of this solar radiation, isn't it? We are receiving less than 1/1000th of millionth when we are around 145 to 153 kilometers. And whatever we receive, around 53% is not reaching our surface at all. 47% is reaching. Among that, majority is being absorbed by the ocean. So whatever is available for us, so you can just imagine the what will be the intensity of the solar radiation. So this solar radiation, again, it dependent on the season. So it depends on the time of the day. So its intensity depends on the time. Morning it will be having low intensity, afternoon it will be having high intensity, again in the evening it will be having low intensity. It completely depends on the time of the day, latitude, the season, the extent of the cloud cover in the atmosphere, what is the atmospheric pollution, and what is the height of the land or land surface from the sea level. So it is dependent on many other parameters. In spite of all these things, still we are able to receive a good intensity of solar radiation, that not at all places and not at all regions of Earth, that is for sure. So whatever the solar radiations we are, the photons we receive on the Earth's surface can be directly converted into other form. So as of that, the solar radiations cannot be used directly. So it need to be converted into some other form and use it. So that can be done by a process. So normally we make use of solar radiation and convert into other form. So there are three processes by means of which we can convert solar energy into other forms. So one is known as helioelectrical process. As the name says, helio means photons, a solar radiation. So photons are converted into electrical energy. So if we can convert solar energy into electrical energy, then we call it as helioelectrical process. So one more process is heliothermal process. If we can convert helio photons or solar energy into thermal heat energy, so then we call it as heliothermal process. Okay, so there is one more process, what we call it as heliochemical process. That means to say, if the photons or the solar energy are converted into chemical energy, then we can call it as heliochemical process. So example for this helioelectrical process is nothing but our solar cells or the PV cells. The heliothermal process, the example for that is nothing but the solar water heater. Heliochemical process, example for that is nothing but our biomass system. Isn't it? So helioelectrical, heliothermal and heliochemical, these are the three processes by means of which we can convert the solar energy into other form. So directly this process can be done. So direct form is helioelectrical and heliothermal, indirect form is heliochemical. Apart from that, as I said earlier, so sun is the major source of all life on earth and all forms of energy are derived from it. So even if the wind energy, if the wind has to flow, there should be difference in the density. The difference in density is caused by the temperature. How the temperature is induced into the air? By solar radiation. Similarly, with respect to tides also, difference in the ocean currents, ocean thermal energy, ideal energy. So there should be a difference in density, then only water flows. There should be a difference in density, then only ocean current occurs. There should be a difference in density, then only tides occur. Okay, all these things are possible only from the major source, which is nothing but the solar or the sun energy. So here we will discuss one by one. So first let us go for helioelectrical and heliothermal process, and then we'll discuss all the wind energy and other indirect forms of solar energy conversion. So first let us discuss about heliothermal process. As the name says, heliothermal, converting solar energy into heat energy. The very best example for that is our household solar water heater. Solar water heater. So how do we extract the energy possessed by the sun? So that is normally done by the use of a flat plate collector. So this is the sectional view of a flat plate collector. You can, it is very simple in construction. So you can just see there are tubes here. So these are nothing but the water carrying tubes. Okay, and over these tubes you can just see that there is a transparent cover. So you can just see that here also. So this is the flat plate collector. If you can just see here, these are the tubes which will be carrying the water through it. Below the tubes, you can just see there is a black surface. So why we are using black surface? Because we know that black absorbs maximum amount of solar radiation. So below these tubes, we will be having a black surface. And at the top, there will be a glass covering, transparent glass, which actually transmits the solar radiations into the tubes. So this is the construction of a flat plate collector. It's very simple in construction. We don't require much. We just require some tubes to carry the water. Below that, we require a black surface which can absorb maximum amount of it. And at the top, you'll be having a glazing sheet or a transparent glass cover. Okay. So what we normally do is, we take out, this is being connected to a water storage tank. So sometimes we use same storage for both hot water as well as cold water. Sometimes we use two different tanks. So what happens? The cold water is made to flow through these tubes. So you can just see. So this is the cold water and this is the hot water. So cold water is made to flow through these tubes. As the water flows through these tubes, what happens? This is for a flat plate collector is being exposed to solar radiation. See, as this solar radiation or the photons are emitted on this. So due to this black surface, maximum amount of photons are being absorbed by these black surfaces. And over this black surface, what do we have? We have the tubes which are carrying, or the pipes which are carrying the water. So we have a cold water entering in. So cold water means what? Low temperature, but it will be having high density. When the temperature is low, density will be high. So as it flows through it, what happens? It starts observing the heat. As it starts observing the heat, what happens?
temperature increases, temperature of the water increases. As the temperature increases, the density decreases. So that means to say, within the tube itself, there exists a difference in density of water. So that means to say, the incoming cold water, which is high in density, will push what? The water inside the tube, which is low in density, and thereby the water will start flowing up. So by the time it starts flowing up, so it will be remaining in those tubes for a longer duration because it has to climb up, right? So it takes some time. So it will flow very slowly. When it is flowing very slowly, obviously it will be absorbing more amount of heat and again gets converted from warm water to very hot water. So that means the temperature water of water keeps on increasing. By the time it comes out, it will be an hot water which is stored back for our usage. So this is how a solar water heater works. So in our household solar water heater, you can just see this is or the solar flat plate collector which absorbs the heat energy, and thereby we are converting the heat energy photon or the solar energy into heat energy. So water possesses heat energy and that is being taken out for our usage. So this is an heliothermal process where we are converting solar energy into heat energy. So how we are extracting the heat? By means of a solar flat plate collector. There is one more type of collector what we can use is a parabolic collector. See, in the flat plate collector, the disadvantage is what? There are chances of the solar radiation getting reflected back. But that is being avoided by the use of a parabolic converter. So the concept is very simple. So instead of having a flat plate, you have a parabolic shape receiver. So here you have a pipe which is carrying the water. See, whenever a solar radiation is incident on this, in flat plate collector, there is a chances of reflecting back. But here, since it is having a parabolic shape, even if it gets reflected, it will be get reflected and fall back into the receiver itself. So that means to say, by the use of parabolic converter, we will be able to concentrate more quantity of photons or the solar radiations. So that loss, what you can see in this flat plate collector, can be avoided here in case of parabolic converter, or otherwise it is same. So we are basically extracting the heat and making the water to get heated. So it is nothing but an heliothermal process, converting solar energy into heat energy. Okay. So there is one more example for making use of this solar energy and convert that into heat energy. That is solar pond. So this kind of pond you can see in most of the places where we try to extract heat from the solar energy and try to run a turbine. So how does this work? So we will be creating an artificial pond. So this is the pond what you can see. We can create an artificial pond. To the bottom surface of this pond, we will be covering that with a polypropylene thick sheets, so that, and moreover, it will be an absorbent, so it will absorb maximum amount of radiation, and at the same time it will not make the salt also to go into the earth. So it prevents both. It prevents infiltration of the sand or salt into the sand, as well as it absorbs maximum amount of radiation. So what we do in this case is we will be filling this pond with a water, and we will be adding saline to it, or nothing but the salt to it. So normally the salt what we make use is a magnesium chloride, sodium chloride, and sodium nitrate. So these are some of the salts what we use. So we just fill the pond with water and we'll add salt to it. So all this salt, like sodium chloride or magnesium chloride or sodium nitrate, so they are mixed into. So what happens to that? So when this pond is now being exposed to the solar radiation, when this sand is pond is being exposed to solar radiation, what happens? You have an saline water here. When it is being exposed to the solar radiations, the water at the upper level, what happens? Initially, it will be having a uniform density. But once it is being exposed to solar radiation, so slowly you can observe there will be three layers formed in the pond. What are those three layers? So those three, the top layer or the uppermost layer is what we call it as upper convection zone. And the middle one, what you can see in the blue color, what you can see at the top is the upper convection zone. The yellow color, what you can see here in this sketch is the non-convective zone. And the lowermost orange color, what you can see in this sketch is what we call it as the lower convective zone. Upper convective zone, non-convective zone and lower convective zone. So when the salt water is continuously exposed to sun, so because of the natural process, so three layers are formed. So what is the difference between these three layers? So normally the upper zone, what we call it as an upper convective zone, since the upper layer of the water is directly exposed to sun compared to the lower layers, right? So this upper convective zone will receive maximum amount of heat compared to lower levels. This upper level of water gets heated fast compared to lower one. So once it gets heated fast, what happens? It loses the density, isn't it? The temperature of the water increases. It loses the density. Once it loses the density means what? Automatically the salt content in the water is removed. Where does the salt go? The salt go and settle at the bottom. Not only the water, even the salt would have fetched heat from the solar radiation, isn't it? So as the temperature of the water at the upper level increases, so salt gets separated and it settles at the down. So upper surface is lower density. As the salts go and settle down, obviously at the lowermost level of the pond, it will be high density. And moreover, the salt as it moves from the upper level to lower level, it will be carrying heat. Directly the lower level is also being exposed to heat, but not, it will not receive that much of heat as that of an upper level, isn't it? So these salt are the carriers which carry the heat from the top level to the bottom level. That means to say there exists a difference in the temperature, don't you think so? Isn't it? Here you have an high density, here you have an high density water, and here you have a low density water. So low density, high temperature, high density, low temperature, that means to say they do exist a temperature difference, isn't it? When there exists a temperature difference, we can make use of this difference in temperature and run a turbine. How a turbine runs, anyway, you will be learning all those things in the next module. But this difference in temperature, how can we tap it? So normally to run a turbine, we will be using a low boiling point fluid. Low boiling point means which starts boiling at a very low temperature. So this temperature difference will not be much enough. So therefore we make use of low boiling point temperature fluids, okay, in the turbine. So what happens? This is taken in. So obviously this difference in temperature is measured. One is to evaporate the low boiling liquid. So as it evaporates, it gets converted into steam, and that in turn will run the turbine, isn't it? And thereby you'll be able to get mechanical energy in turn into electrical energy. And the exhaust of the turbine will be away, has to be recycled back. So what do we do in that case? We make use of lower temperature water, okay, so to cool it back and recirculate that in the turbine. So this difference in the temperature between the upper level and the lower level are made use to run a turbine which works on a low boiling point fluid. So this is how we'll be able to convert solar energy into electrical energy. So first, directly we are not converting into electrical energy. So first we are converting solar energy into mechanical energy by running a turbine, and in turn mechanical energy into electrical energy. Please have a look on how this solar pond works.
Moving ahead, so I hope you understood the working of a solar pond. We will discuss helioelectrical process. So far the solar water heater and the solar pond, what we discuss is an heliothermal process, converting solar energy into heat energy. So one of our process of conversion is a helioelectrical process, so whereby we'll be converting solar energy into electrical energy directly by the use of the photovoltaic cell, or what we call it as the solar cell. The construction is very simple. We'll be making use of a separate material known as a semiconductor. In order to convert the solar energy into electrical energy, we will be making use of a special material known as semiconductor. So what is a semiconductor? A semiconductor is a thin wafer which is being exposed to sun. There are two types of semiconductor. One is known as an P-type semiconductor and the other one is as an N-type semiconductor. So the best example is the silicon, and they are joined together, and this is the in between layer is what we call it as a depletion layer. And this semiconductor, which is a very thin layer, on one side we have a N-type, on the other side we have a P-type, is now being exposed to solar radiations or the photons directly. Okay, so that means to say, when it is being exposed to the solar radiation, so what happens in this semiconductor means, some of the solar photons are absorbed in the vicinity of the NP junction. NP junction means nothing but the depletion layer which is in between. Okay, so some of the solar photons are absorbed in the vicinity of the PN junction, and in the process what happens, the electrons in the valence band get excited. The electrons in the valence band get excited, and these excited electrons, they move from the lower band to the higher band. So which is the lower band here? The valence band. So valence band is the lower band and the conduction band are the higher band. So when these electrons get excited, they move from lower energy band to higher energy band, that is from the valence band to conduction band. When it starts moving from valence band to conduction band, these electrons, they'll be leaving a hole behind. So this creates an electron hole pair in the material, isn't it? So as the photons are incident, these electrons get excited and they move from the valence band to conduction band, that is from low energy band to higher energy band. As it starts jumping from that, it will leave an hole, and thereby an electron hole pair is created in the material. And these electrons, as you know, that are negatively charged and the holes are positively charged. So electrons are negatively charged and holes are positively charged. So obviously all these electrons which are negatively charged will start concentrating towards the N-type of the semiconductor, and all these holes which are positively charged will start concentrating on the P-type side of the semiconductor. So when all the electrons negatively charged are on one side and all the positive charged holes are on the other side, what happens? There is a difference in the electric field. So that means an electric field do exist, and they start moving in the opposite direction. When an external load is connected, an external load cell is connected, and due to this difference in the potential energy, so obviously electric current starts flowing in. So this is how we will be able to convert the solar energy or the photons into electrical energy. So by the use of a semiconductor, we will be able to convert solar energy into electrical energy, and this is most commonly used solar cell in our day-to-day life. And these solar cells are very compact, very easy to construct, they have got a long life and has got little maintenance. And the only disadvantage is the power output is very less. Okay, you can get an unlimited energy source. Sometimes it is very less efficient and the power output is very less. Okay, except that it is very easy in construction, has got a long life, low maintenance and very easy. So this is how we'll be able to trap the energy processed by the sun or the solar energy into electrical energy. Convert that into an electrical energy. So let's have a look of how we'll be trapping the energy using solar.
The most commonly used renewable energy source is solar energy. But how is solar energy used to generate electricity? A photovoltaic or PV system is used to convert the solar or light energy into electrical energy. The basic component of the PV system is known as the solar cell. A single solar cell has the capacity of producing about 0.5 volts of electricity. A solar panel or solar module is the combination of several solar cells connected in series to generate usable voltage. The solar panel voltage can be increased by increasing the number of solar cells. For example, 30 solar cells connected in series will produce an output of 15 volts. A combination of solar panels connected together is known as solar array and can be used to achieve required current and voltage. How does the solar cell work? The generation of electricity on exposure to sunlight is known as the photovoltaic effect. This principle is used by solar cells to produce electricity. The solar cells are made up of semiconductors, mainly silicon, and comprises three layers. The top layer, called the N-type layer, is comparatively thin and contains high concentration of electrons. The bottom layer, called the P-type layer, contains high concentration of holes. When the P-type and the N-type semiconductor is joined, it forms a P-N junction. On forming a P-N junction, the electrons of the N-type material try to reach the P region, creating a negatively charged layer. Similarly, the holes of the P-type material try to reach the N region, creating a positively charged layer. This region between the two layers is known as the depletion region of the semiconductor. Sunlight penetrates the top thin layer easily to reach the depletion region. Due to the deficiency of charge in the depletion region, it contains neutral atoms. These neutral atoms are broken when the photons from the sunlight strike the depletion layer. This knocks the electrons from the neutral atoms, leaving behind the holes and producing free charge carriers. Then, the electrons move towards the N-type layer and the holes move towards the P-type layer due to the electric field present in the depletion region. On connecting an electronic circuit, the electrons flow through it generating electricity to electrical devices like bulb, fan, etc. Please subscribe our channel and join with us. Thank you. Let's grow up. Never.
So we have come to the end of lesson 2. So where in this lesson we did discuss about hydropower plant, where we are converting energy processed by the water into mechanical, in turn into electrical energy. And then we did discuss about the solar energy and its conversion process. So under solar energy conversion, we did discuss heliothermal process and helioelectrical process. So heliothermal process, where we'll be converting heat energy, photons or solar energy into heat energy, and helioelectrical process, where we converted solar energy into electrical energy. So we'll see you on again in the last lesson. Thank you.